This is one of these tweets where like I just sit and pause and be like, who the hell is this Ryan Sean Adams man? My mind goes to like, all right, he's an AI, so he just like did Google searching and came up with this, so that's just normal. Or he's a Taylor Swift fan and like had this one ready to go. Or he's a dad of a teenage daughter.
It could be all three things at once. We just don't know. And I think you have to be comfortable, David, if we're going to continue this podcast every week, is living in that ambiguity.
Oh,
do you know?
God.
Like you just don't really know. Bankless Nation, happy second Friday of the month. David, tell them what time it is.
Oh, it's the Friday Bankless Weekly Roll-Up, where we cover the entire weekly news in this goddamn bear market, which is an especially ambitious endeavor, yet we persevere. Nonetheless, no matter what corner of the globe we're tuning in from, which is a little bit different for me this week, Ryan. It's one of those weeks.
Yeah, you're West Coast.
West Coast. David's back. Yeah, back in the beautiful, beautiful city of San Diego. Yeah.
Yeah.
Much to the demise of my mother that I didn't decide to go back to Seattle.
Yeah, you went a little south of of your mom. But, you know, she could always meet you in San Diego, right? It could be a rendezvous point.
That would be insulting to her.
Okay, so the intro, though. You said bear market, but we sounded so, like upbeat and enthusiastic. And I felt some energy there. Like, I feel... Okay. Do you know how I feel coming to this episode, David, is like a weight has been lifted off my shoulders.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, I feel light. November was not a great month for crypto.
No, that could have been the worst month ever, in fact.
Do you know how you feel like after, you say you feel after you fast for a couple of days?
Yeah.
You got kind of the energy. You got, I don't know if you've detoxified
or something. I call it my manic David. Yeah.
Yeah, manic David.
In a good way.
Yeah, once in a while, not in a Kanye West way. But like once in a while, you'll DM me and you'll be like, I got some ideas. I'm like, okay, it's manic David. And I don't say that. I'm like, it's fasted David. Anyway, that's a little
same.
How I feel. I feel like we've got detoxed and like I'm just feeling, even though it's a bear market,
clarity in thought, like long-term time horizons.
Yes.
Yeah, just like fundamental optimism. Yeah, okay. All right.
Excited about 2023? Are you feeling that vibe or is it just me?
I want to get to 2023 so bad, not because time is a construct, but like, I don't know, January 1st, 2023, like, can we get there, please? Because then everything just goes away and we just reset, right?
All right. Yeah. It goes away. We could forget
SBF 2022. SBF is in jail. Crypto prices are up only. This is what I'm promised.
We get some sensible regulation for DeFi passed. Who else? Vitalik is elected president. No, he can't. He's Canadian. I don't know, man. A lot of good things maybe in 2023. We'll see. All right, let's talk about the topics of the week, though.
This is the state in the bear market where we just make shit up, dude.
No, this is a real thing that happened. Apple versus Coinbase. Okay. Apple thinks it can tax crypto, David. Who's going to tell them? Who's going to tell them that they can't tax ETH gas fees? We're going to talk about that.
No one seems to be able to tell Apple no, which is kind of the crazy thing. We have to talk about that. Also, we got some data, some fallout, some actual numbers to talk about when it comes to contagion out of Genesis and Gemini Earn. So we'll give you the numbers that we heard that was reported. And then also coming in hot, you'll never guess, Ryan, who SBF hired as a lawyer. I kind of feel like this whole SBF story is coming to a close. I might have said that before on previous roll-ups, but like everyone last week, we were confused as to what the hell SBF was doing on his like public tour of talking to everyone. Now I feel like we kind of know what he's up to and we've got some clarity there. So that's what's coming up in the big news of the week.
And he's got his lawyer. You don't hire a lawyer when things are going well. So we'll see who that is in the show. You'll never guess the name. Pretty crazy, actually. Hey, but before we get into it, gotta shout out our friends and sponsors at Oplus, who have a very special message for the Bankless Nation. They want to provide you with healthcare going into 2023. That's real important. If you're a contractor, if you're working for a DAO, tell them what Oplus is and what are they offering today for Bankless listeners.
Because of the burdens of nation state employment and other things in this life that we live, things like healthcare, things like payroll taxes, working on the frontier of Web3 is difficult. How, as a DAO worker or as an NFT artist or as, I don't know, a yield farmer, do you access... Well, yeah, if you don't have a company that you work for, but you're making money, how do you get healthcare?
It's all
healthcare in the United States is super expensive, especially as an individual. So Opolis is a co-op for all the Web3 workers on the frontier who want to band together in Web3 fashion to come, and Opolis will negotiate for advantaged rates on your behalf. Opolis, it's a co-op. So that means when you sign up for Opolis, you also become an owner of Opolis. And Opolis just does things to help you with your burdensome nation state infrastructure that you need. Again, healthcare, payroll taxes, all this kind of stuff. And there is a link in the show notes to get started. And if you get started, if you get going with Opolis by December 31st of 2022, so that's like 20 days, you will get 1,000 work, the token for Opolis, and 1,000 bank tokens. Allow Opolis to help you do what you do best, which is explore the frontier, but with healthcare.
Web3 workers, unite. That's what we need. A lot to build, and so we need a lot of work to get done. David, let's talk about markets before we get into building. What is Bitcoin looking at this week? We got the happy music or sad?
Bitcoin, it's got no music. It is flat. It is flat? Super flat on the week.
Silence.
Up, down 0%.
Like literally 0%?
Yeah, it came pretty damn close to 0%, yeah.
And so what is that? What number are we looking at? About
17,000? Oh, yeah, the number. $17,000. Yeah. $17,000 Bitcoin.
It's also like 17,000 even. That's pretty crazy. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. How about ETH, up or down?
Sad sounds for ETH. Down 2.5%. Started the week at 1290, ending the week where it currently is at 1250. Although it is surging as of this morning up to 1257.
All right. Well, I can calculate the ratio in my head. I bet it's down 2.5%. Am I right?
That's about right. That's okay. The correct math. This is math that I can understand. Yeah. My ratio is down about 2.5% on the week. We are down to 0.074.
No real signal right now. We're just hanging out in December. This is interesting. A flat week is interesting in these types of markets. So do we feel like this is consistent with what we believe has been the case, where the last domino has kind of fallen, or it's wobbled, and we kind of know the contagion that's already happened, and we're getting into this flat period of time? What do you think?
Sorry, I just got distracted by TradingView because I have it open on my phone. ETH just pumped to 1283. So we are only down 1.5% on the week, Ryan.
Again, none of this will matter by the time you listen to it.
Why do we do this?
I don't know, but we're going to keep doing it every week. We'll tell you 24-hour out-of-date numbers, and you can enjoy them or not.
Is this emblematic of, bad news, but it's going on, like, still, like, everyone hates crypto, regulation, all that stuff, but prices are flat. I feel like that's a pretty acceptable sign of, like, strength. Bad news, but flat prices equals some signal of strength, yeah.
Yeah, flat prices is better than down prices. That's the kind of analysis you guys tune in for every week. All right, we are under $1 trillion, too. What's the crypto market cap? Give us those numbers, David.
Can you hit refresh? Just so we're at $884 billion. If Ryan hits refresh, $889 billion. Look, we just added $5 billion onto the market cap, putting us at flat on the week, because last week it was $890 billion.
Flat on the week. There we go. Flat. It's a flat week, which is okay in a bear market to have. It's better than the alternative. David, we've got to talk a little bit about the bottom signals, because that's really what folks are listening to. And I think we've talked about it in the section of markets the last couple of roll-ups. And we got some more bottom signally stuff. You decide.
Bottom signals are abound.
Are these bottom signals or not? You don't really know until they're like for sure a bottom, but some hypothesis. The ultimate bottom signal caller is Jim Cramer. If he tells you to sell, you better buy. You better. It's probably a bottom. And Jim Cramer, of course, this is the host of Mad Money, who you know and love, the great stock predictor. He says investors should exit crypto. In quotes, it's never too late to sell, is what Jim says. I don't know. I'm super bullish after I'm hearing this from Jim Cramer. Cramer, what's your take on this?
So crypto Twitter and just FinTwit just makes so much fun of Jim Cramer because he is the herd. He is the herd mentality. He is the middle of the curve. And like he told people to buy coin at 450 when it IPO'd. Like he has all of these terribly wrong takes. And actually, if you think about it, Ryan, his business model for Mad Money makes sense because he's trying to get
attention,
eyeballs.
Yeah, it's not about ROI.
And so like he doesn't want, if you are contrarian, you don't want to be a contrarian as like somebody who's trying to get eyeballs as like a TV show, right? You want to dish out what everyone wants to hear. If you're trying to have maximum reach, maximum broad
reach.
You want
to have consensus opinion.
You want to have consensus opinion. And that if you just have consensus opinion in the markets, you're not going to do well. Being smart in the markets is about having contrarian bets. So this is not just a meme. This is like, it's aligned with his business model for Mad Money. So Jim Cramer urges investors to exit crypto. It's never too late to sell. If you want to be a contrarian, you would do the opposite.
I actually think that's a good take on Jim Cramer. It's not that he's always wrong. It's just that he is emblematic of consensus opinion. And this is consensus opinion. He says,
because his takes change every 2 weeks.
It's never too late to sell an awful position. And that's what you have if you own these so-called digital assets, an awful position.
Lumping every single digital asset together.
They're all the same and it's never too late. I mean, this is how people get totally wrecked on the dips here. Anyway, maybe a bottom signal. Here's another one, David. What are we looking at here?
Just 8% of Americans have a positive view of cryptocurrencies now, a CNBC survey finds. This is published on December 7th on Wednesday. When I read this article, Ryan, I was just so reminded of 2018, of just like positive view of crypto in 2017, very negative view of crypto in 2018.
Yes.
It's just consensus. It's just the herd mentality. So if you're telling me that only 8% of Americans have positive views of crypto, like that just sounds like a bottom signal. And of course, the survey is happening right after FTX. Like people are just thinking about crypto for the first time in months. And they're like, oh yeah, FTX is bad. Therefore, crypto is bad.
Yeah, well, I have a more negative view of crypto, I would say, probably over the past month.
that's a good point.
I mean, if you ask me this poll, I'm going to like, but that doesn't mean I'm not long-term bullish. And by the way, this number is 8% now. It was 19% in March. So we got our own halving here, little cut in half. This is pretty consistent, I think, with the conversation. It's also consistent with like pricing and everything else is what you'd start to expect as we hit towards the bottom. 8%. I'm still okay. 8% have a positive view. That's the silver lining. That's not too bad.
Still a chance.
You guys know what crypto is, at least. What's this chart we're looking at?
Yeah, this is the new record low of the GBTC discount. So buying one share of the Grayscale Bitcoin Trust is 47% discounted to how many Bitcoins is backing it. So in theory, if you could redeem those Bitcoins and you bought one Bitcoin's worth of the GBTC trust now, you would get roughly 1.5 Bitcoins if you could redeem them, but you can't.
If Mr. Gensler will convert that to an ETF, then you should be able to redeem it.
Yes,
so this is some sort of regulatory, I don't know what you call that, tomfoolery.
Right. If you have regulatory shenanigans. If you have the longest term time horizons, could be a good buy.
It could be. Not financial advice. You know, we did an entire episode on GBDC. So if folks, you're wondering what GBDC is, your thesis, David, is that GBDC is what started this whole thing.
It is the thing that really started the bull market. So you can't really be too angry, but then also the reason why it all came crashing down.
Yeah, it's the first domino. Anyway, there's an episode. What's that episode titled? What did we end up calling that?
It was the thumbnail is Grayscale and Genesis Contagion, but we renamed it was 2021 just a gigantic Ponzi, which the answer is kind of yes.
You're supposed to tease, not give them the answer. Okay, but yes, it was a Ponzi. Okay, what's this? What's this chart that we're looking at?
This is the coin price, the Coinbase coin
stock.
Token. Jesus, stock. Yes,
the traditional tokens. We call those stocks, David.
Yeah, which Coinbase is coming in at a whopping $9 billion total market cap valuation.
Are you
kidding
me?
$9 billion for
Coinbase. You mean whopping? Like that's so low.
Bad.
Yeah, that's so low. $9 billion?
Extremely low.
Don't we have like alternative layer ones that are way higher than $9 billion right now?
Right. So
Coinbase.
For context, Uniswap coming in at what's the Uniswap price? I think like $6.25. That is a valuation of about $6 billion. So
really?
Coinbase is 50% more valued than Uniswap.
And UniToken doesn't even have any legal guarantees on
investor protections. Yes, right.
Does
reminder that DeFi tokens are just tokens and we don't know what they are.
Well, there's hope, but you know, yeah. And by the way, there's news of more discussion about Uni token fees being flipped on, but also that is really close. I mean, mm-hmm. wouldn't it be crazy if Uniswap token price flipped from a market cap perspective coin? What does that mean? Does this mean coin is like silly low, or like what does this mean?
Coin is silly low. I think the coin, the equity of Coinbase is going to outperform 99% of tokens that you see on CoinGecko.
Let me put it this way. Jim Cramer would be telling you to sell your coin right now. Let me put it that way.
It's not too late.
Not too late to sell your coin. Speaking of all of these token prices, one of the things our analyst team at Bankless puts together is what we call the Bankless Token Bible. And this is kind of an analyst in a box service if you're a Bankless Premium member. I'm actually showing some of it here, but this is usually like...
Brian's leaking the alpha.
I shouldn't be leaking this alpha. In fact, I'll flip off the page. But this is like a master spreadsheet of mm-hmm. our overweight, underweight kind of scores from our analyst team. And you can sort of see why. It's kind of a beta version of the product of what it will be in mm-hmm. the next launch of our Bankless 2.0 website and everything.
One
premium
of many
experience.
2.0 launches, yeah.
Yeah, but it's something I wanted to just shout out because our team's doing a fantastic job. And I don't think we talk about this very often, mm-hmm. but like you can click in through Balancer and look right now, this is all just like Google Doc pages. So you can see how it's like kind of raw. Underweight for Aptos. Why are we underweight for Aptos?
I don't know. Let's go read about it and see what Ben, the analyst, put into the doc.
That's right. Ben, by the way, is a fantastic analyst on our team. He's where we get all of our DeFi alpha. Anyway, we have that all available to Bankless Premium members. So it's just a shout out to upgrade so you can see what that looks like. And all of this will be redesigning our new website. Speaking of token prices, David, let's talk about this. This was a tweet I saw from Jacob Franek, and this is a tweet about stablecoin mm-hmm. market cap. All right. So about a year ago, February 27th, we had $166 billion worth of stablecoins on-chain issued. And this is mm-hmm. all this kind of stablecoins, right? So centralized, decentralized. December 4th, $139 billion. So down. Okay. Not by a dramatic amount, but down by about like what, $25 billion? Something
billion,
like
$27
billion. Yeah. David did the math.
I did the math there.
It's interesting that BUSD is the stablecoin that's growing, the only stablecoin mm-hmm. that's growing, not contracting. But what was more interesting to me about this is, do you remember Jim Bianco's thesis? Uh-huh. So Jim Bianco, repeat Bankless podcast friend, and just fantastic views on traditional markets, but also like knows an incredible amount about like crypto and DeFi and like really digs in.
He's an S tier individual.
I love Jim Bianco. Go follow Jim Bianco uh-huh. on Twitter. Jim, if you're listening, man, we appreciate you. He had kind of a thesis he actually asked our opinion on. And I was like, I don't know, Jim, that sounds right. You should write more about this. And his thesis was, DeFi, the liquidity for DeFi is through stablecoins. So if you want to measure kind of the economic bandwidth of DeFi, mm-hmm. right? We'll put it another way. If you want DeFi to grow, stablecoin market cap has to grow. Mm-hmm. And so we have about $140 billion of stablecoin economic bandwidth in DeFi. And if we want to 10x DeFi, we need to 10x the stablecoin value.
And specifically 10x DeFi prices, to be specific.
DeFi prices,
he was saying DeFi
use,
token prices, like all things like
all
liquidity, stablecoin liquidity is the underlying foundation, which makes sense, especially after we've done all of our Federal Reserve macro episodes.
Yes.
Everyone is like, yeah, the Fed, the markets are addicted to liquidity. When we're pulling liquidity out of the market, everything's selling. So
liquidity.
It makes sense along those lines.
Totally
like
makes
if
sense.
You give more stablecoin liquidity to DeFi, yields go up, token prices go up, things, everything else above it goes up.
So first of all, Jim or some other talented listener should do some analysis on this and run the data and do some kind of like, you know, models with historical data and see to what extent this has played out and what the correlation is. But also, I'm interested to look at this over time as sort of a leading indicator. If you want to see DeFi start to recover, we might need to see that stablecoin value on-chain tick up and hit from $140 billion, $200 billion. 300 mm-hmm. billion. This might be some kind of a bullish sign to precede a run up. Anyway, 100%. Good thesis there.
Yeah. Jim, if you're wondering what an S tier individual is, S is above A. S stands for super.
I'm glad you explained that for me. the right. trend continues. People are going bankless, David. What's this?
Yeah, Will Clemente says, tweets out, over the last 30 days, 200,000 bitcoins. Reminder, out of 21 million, 200,000 bitcoins worth $3.4 billion has been moved off exchanges. I don't think there's ever been a greater migration of bitcoins, or probably value in general, off of centralized exchanges into self-custody wallets. Well, even before Mt. Gox, right? Like, you can't even see Mt.
Yeah,
Gox.
Yeah, all the red here. Yeah. Well, this is, yeah, I think you're right. Is this
well, that's terms? Because it's measured in dollars.
Yeah. More in Bitcoin, but dollars. You're right.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Biggest red over time we've mm-hmm. ever seen. That's incredible. I mean, people are just like, I don't trust exchanges. See you later. Self-custody, right. going bankless.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's not how I wanted it to happen, but okay. So I saw these two tweets out of Token Terminal that I wanted to include in here. So this is a developer activity overlaid by price for two ecosystems. Well, first, we're looking at Cosmos. Developer activity looks like the start of a bull run. It starts to look like a very healthy line up.
That's
the
green
right.
line.
That's the green line.
That's a steady kind of mm-hmm. upward trajectory for the last yep. over the last 2 years.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then, I mean, we all know the price. The price is largely uncorrelated. Although the Cosmos token actually is kind of like up and to the right. It has this like middle chunk, which is definitely a manic bull market. Yeah. But now we're like at the trend that it was before the bull market in like 2019 to 2020.
Not manic, just fully fasted and full of energy.
Jesus. Let me tell you, I was not fasting during the bull market. And then so we can flip over to, we can compare this to the Ethereum chart, which is the next tweet. Ethereum actually saw for some reason, a drop off in developer activity in the last like couple months or so. You can get this overlay developer activity still over like the long term at all absolute all time highs. And the ETH price is at a very much higher floor than it was in 2018. I just thought these were interesting.
I think they're interesting. Now, my mm-hmm. big question in this, if you want to get to kind of the second question, is, okay, but does your Atom token map to developers in the Cosmos ecosystem? Because this is like, it's not the empire model that Ethereum is, where all value flows back to ETH, the token, right? Because of the mechanism design. ETH, yeah. mm-hmm. But Cosmos, it's not necessarily true in any respect that all value leads back to the Atom token. It could mm-hmm. accrue in other app chains inside of Cosmos, right?
Which is the bull case of the Cosmos thesis, is that yes. the value does accrue elsewhere. And that's yeah, exactly. one of the big advantages and selling points of the Cosmos ecosystem.
Exactly. Which is why, of course, you can't like, you have to understand this space in order to, like, you can't take a Jim Cramer level. We're picking on Jim today. You can't take a Jim Cramer level, like, analysis, look at these two charts and be like, well, it means this, because this number is going right. up here, it means this mm-hmm. number in this other ecosystem. You have to think about it more fully. David, what else we got coming up next, my friend?
Coming up next, Coinbase versus Apple. Does Apple even understand crypto? Do they even care? A lot of people seem to be going up against Apple. How many more until it takes for something to happen there? I don't know, but we're going to talk about it. And then we got some data out of Genesis and Gemini Earn to share. And SBF, of course. We got to tie the bow on the SBF conversation because, like I said in the intro, I finally feel like we know what SBF is up to, or at least I'll give my takes. All this stuff and more right after we talk to some of these fantastic sponsors to help you go bankless. Arbitrum One is pioneering the world of secure Ethereum scalability and is continuing to accelerate the Web3 landscape. Hundreds of projects have already deployed on Arbitrum One, producing flourishing DeFi and NFT ecosystems. With the recent addition of Arbitrum Nova, gaming and social dApps like Reddit are also now calling Arbitrum home. Both Arbitrum One and Nova leverage the security and decentralization of Ethereum and provide a builder experience that's intuitive, familiar, and fully EVM compatible. On Arbitrum, both builders and users will experience faster transaction speeds with significantly lower gas fees. With Arbitrum's recent migration to Arbitrum Nitro, it's also now 10 times faster than before. Visit arbitrum.io, where you can join the community, dive into the developer docs, bridge your assets, and start building your first dApp. With Arbitrum, experience Web3 development the way it was meant to be. Secure, fast, cheap, and friction-free. The Brave Wallet
is your secure multi-chain on-ramp into Web3, and it's built directly into the Brave privacy browser. Gone are the days of managing multiple wallet extensions that put you at risk of phishing, spoofs, and tracking. With the Brave wallet, you can securely manage your crypto assets across more than 100 different chains, including Ethereum, Layer 2s, Solana, and more, all without downloading risky extensions. The Brave wallet is easy to set up and removes the headache of jumping between wallets and extensions. It's lightweight, but packed with great features, like built-in token swaps, buying and holding NFTs with a gallery view, and support for hardware wallets. But also much more than that, because Brave is shipping new features every single month, with a mission to make Web3 easier to navigate for its over 55 million users. Wallet extensions are a thing of the past, so get started with Brave's Web3-ready browser today and experience a decentralized web seamlessly without all the clutter. You can download the browser at brave.com/bankless and click the wallet icon to get started.
Coinbase and Apple in a head-to-head, Apple wanting to tax DeFi transactions and crypto transactions, and Coinbase not liking it. David, you have the tweet thread here. Let's look at Coinbase's position on things and give some of our takes. What's Coinbase saying?
Yeah, so they tweeted out of the Coinbase wallet. So this is from the Coinbase wallet, not Coinbase. Yeah, so important small differentiator. You might have noticed you can't send NFTs on the Coinbase iOS wallet anymore. This is because Apple blocked our last app release until we disabled the feature. The feature of being able to send NFTs. Apple was like, you guys have to block that before you update your app.
Okay, so Coinbase wallet is like a non-custodial, self-custodial wallet. It's a bankless wallet. It's not their full custodial solution. We're talking about the wallet, just like MetaMask, only on your phone.
Mobile.
And this basic functionality of sending an NFT from one place to another, just like sending an ERC-20 or ETH from one place to another, sending stablecoins, making a payment, they had to disable that. Because Apple blocked them?
Yes, because the Apple says you guys have to block that feature before we allow you guys to push that app update.
My God.
And so the tweet thread continues and says, Apple's claim is that the gas fee required to send NFTs need to be paid through their in-app purchase system so they can collect 30% of the gas fee.
What?
And so I think the next tweet just really summarizes this. For anyone who understands how NFTs and blockchains work, this is clearly not possible. Apple's proprietary in-app purchase system does not support crypto, so we couldn't comply even if we tried. Okay, so Apple wants Coinbase Wallet to send them 30% of the gas fee that it takes to send an NFT. If Coinbase Wallet were to do this, they would have to pass that charge on to the customers, so they would have to take the gas fee and add on 30% so that they could pay Apple. But then there's a new number, and then you would have to actually add on, take 30% of that new amount of that 30%, because like that's the new number that Apple would have to take. It doesn't make any sense.
It's shocking to me that Apple thinks it can do this. We're talking about an ETH transaction fee that is nothing to do with Coinbase. This is the base protocol fee inside of Ethereum, and gas prices are set by the market, blocks-based demand versus blocks-based supply, and whatever the demand is going for. So the gas fee can be different every single transaction. It could be a dollar, it could be $5, it could be $20. And you're saying that Apple wants 30% of that.
Yeah.
It's kind of not Coinbase's to give. Do you know what I mean?
Like,
they would
they're trying to tax Ethereum 30% and say, hey, if you want to use Ethereum, you got to pay us 30% of the fee.
So weird. All right, go on. What else do they say?
One of the important tweets that I liked was that the biggest impact of this policy change is on iPhone users that own NFTs. If you hold an NFT in a wallet on an iPhone, Apple just made it a lot harder to transfer that NFT to other wallets or gift it to friends or family. This one hit home for me, Ryan, because there was one time we were at Bankless, gifted Cool Cats by William Pister. He minted them, sent them all to us. And then I passed my Cool Cat along to a friend using MetaMask Mobile. I had it on my MetaMask wallet. I sent it to a friend who went down the crypto rabbit hole so hard, left her job, became a marketer for a crypto job because of I sent her a Cool Cat with a mobile wallet. So I have a personal story about like how I onboarded a person by sending them a Cool Cat because of a mobile transfer, right? Spontaneous moment. Definitely wouldn't have done it if I had waited to get home to a ledger. We just, so like, this is just Apple just being like a baron and just like
a landowner.
This is like racketeering.
It's like a feudal lord. And this tweet above from Coinbase says, this is akin to Apple trying to take a cut of fees for every email that gets sent over open internet protocols.
Yeah.
Imagine that if there was a tax that iOS charged for internet protocols and for email.
Yeah. So Apple, I don't know. The debate here is, does Apple know what they're doing or do they not know what they're doing? Do they know the significance of this choice or are they just being like errant?
I don't know. I think it's interesting that we haven't heard anything yet from MetaMask about them blocking MetaMask, which of course you have the same functionality in MetaMask or other mobile wallets like Phantom. So maybe it's an oversight. At the same time, like I haven't heard of this being remedied, and it's like 7 days later from when Coinbase is tweeting this. And just the how do they not know this? Just like the idea that they could
tax. Pretty egregious.
Yeah, it's pretty egregious. And I think this is not, crypto is not the only industry that's facing this. I mean, Tim Sweeney from Epic Games has talked about Apple's monopoly power, and basically making it such that in-app purchases or like in-game purchases all have to throw through this land baron and this feudal lord. They get a cut of everything. They're adding no value in the process. This is just rent-seeking behavior, isn't it?
Yeah.
And you can only do rent-seeking behavior if you have a monopoly. And in this case, I mean, I have an iPhone, right?
Do you have 17 Apple products.
Okay. So they kind of like, they have that power over consumers. Yeah. And I don't know how you get this to stop. Obviously, the free market approaches competitors, and you disrupt Apple, and you create kind of a different mobile experience that's more open. There's also the regulatory approach, where some nation state says, "No, we have a bigger stick, and we'll whack you." And
our monopoly
not let
is bigger
you
than
this.
Yours. We have guns.
we have a military. So that's the other way things get done. But I don't know where this ends. It's just pretty egregious, isn't it?
Yeah, that's the conversation that I've seen outside of crypto Twitter, outside of crypto media, is that like Apple wants to take 30% of everything. I think I saw that in like a TechCrunch article, that headline. And at some point, it just gets down to like antitrust. At some point, we're just going to take that. There's enough of a cohort of people that are offended by Apple trying to rake them of 30% that people are just going to take.
Don't they make enough money on their like the hardware that they sell, their great products? Like, that's cool.
I don't think you can ask a company to try and make less money. I don't think
make less
like
money.
That. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Apple, you should make less money. we'll see what Tim Cook says. Tim Cook on Bankless. Let's go. All right. What's this? Genesis?
Genesis. Okay. How much did Gemini customers have in Gemini Earn that went to Genesis? The answer to that is $900 million, which is kind of
just
a doozy.
Shy of $1 billion.
That's a little bit of a doozy.
In Gemini, this is just in Gemini Earn. So this is Gemini not all Earn. Genesis obligations. We're now focused because there is money stuck for retail in Gemini Earn. And it's to the tune of $900 million that Genesis owes Gemini.
Yep.
What does this mean, David? Are we going to get that back?
I don't know. Like people were talking about like the Winklevi just making Gemini earn customers whole. And I was like, oh, in theory, it's possible.
They're
like,
billionaires.
They're billionaires.
Big check.
That's a big check. That's a really big check. I don't think they'd do that.
Well, what is the correspondence of the feedback from Genesis and Gemini? Have they talked about this? This is a headline that says, Genesis says plans to resolve lending units woes could take weeks, in quotes. So, I mean, Genesis is still
trying.
I'm going
to take the over on that one.
It could be like, God bless you, Joe Lubin weeks, where it's weeks, not months kind of thing.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. I don't know, man. I don't know. So
there wasn't too much data beyond what was those two articles. 900 million may take weeks to resolve. It's going to take months.
We'll keep you guys updated on this. David, you said you had some final insights into SBF.
Yep.
Like you feel like that is starting to wind down.
Yep.
And you said Nick Carter was right. What is he right about? Is this a whole tweet thread or should I go to a specific thing here?
So the top tweet is a tweet that we shared last week on the weekly rollup when we collectively, as SBF was going through his public media tour, talking to everyone, making them look like fools, by the way, people were giving their takes.
This as to why, tweet, because it's very bizarre behavior. It seemed non-rational.
Exactly. So one of the takes that we shared was Sam isn't behaving like a renegade who is ignoring the advice of his lawyers. He's behaving like a world-class, like he has a world-class crisis management firm and legal team constructing a very specific and deliberate public narrative. That's one of the takes that we shared from Nick Carter.
4D chess. Sam is doing this all intentionally. Exactly. He knows exactly what he's doing.
Yep. Yep. God, now whenever I say yep, I'm like, that's what Sam says when,
long pause.
Anyways, SBF, a tweet went out this week. SBF of FTX has hired Mark Cohen as his attorney. Cohen recently defended Ghislaine Maxwell in her sex trafficking trial and defended El Chapo prior to that. And Nick Carter says, takes a victory lap and he says, like, as I said, yes, he's got a rock star legal defense.
Wow. All right.
Him.
So when I first saw this, first of all, I thought it was Michael Cohen. It's not Michael Cohen. All right. This is a different Cohen. This is a guy named Mark Cohen.
Yeah.
And he's the lawyer who defended Maxwell.
Yeah.
In the sex trafficking case. Right. And El Chapo.
The whole Epstein thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The Epstein thing. And El Chapo, the drug lord.
Yeah. I don't know this if it gets higher than that.
No, this is who you hire when you are like a hardened criminal, but like at least El Chapo. Uh-huh. I don't know about Maxwell. And you're super wealthy.
God, right. Can you imagine being like if being a client of a lawyer and your other fellow clients are Ghislaine Maxwell and El Chapo? Like, you're not in a good spot.
No. Yeah. Well, you know, how many lawyers would apply for this type of a job? I don't know.
The other joke about this when this was going out was that like Sam Bankman-Fried said that he only has $100,000 left in his bank account. So who's paying for this?
Wait, he said that?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. He said that a couple times. People ask him like, all right, so like how much money do you have left, Sam? And he's like, I've got one credit card that works and I think I've got like $100,000 in my bank account.
Like, no way.
So who's paying this guy?
My God. So he has no crypto? He has no crypto assets?
Allegedly. I don't believe a single damn word out of that man's mouth.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Go on. What else do you think about this story? What's happening here?
Yeah, so there was an interaction between SBF and Maxine Waters, which drew a lot of attention, which is the next tweet, Ryan, if you want to hop over to that one.
And refresh us, who is Maxine Waters? She is on the U.S. House Committee of Financial Services, right? Yes. So she's in the House.
Seen before FTX collapse, blowing a kiss to SBF in as he walked out of his hearing that he had way long ago.
Like in real life kiss.
Yes.
Out of a hearing. In Congress.
Yes. Blew him a kiss. Because he donated billions of dollars to her and the Democrats.
But that's on like TV. That's on like C-SPAN or something. And you're blowing a kiss.
Yes, to SBF.
Seems like strange behavior.
As he walked out. Yes. Strange. Anyways. Okay. Maxine Waters and co-tweeted with Finance Senate Committee Democrat Twitter account. She goes, SBF, we appreciate that you've been candid in your discussions about what happened at FTX. Your willingness to talk to the public will help the company's customers, investors, and others. To that end, we would welcome your participation in our hearing on the 13th. What is this tone,
this
dude?
Is really soft.
What?
This is on December 2nd, right? Uh-huh. So we appreciate that you've been candid in your discussions about what happened at FTX. He has not been candid.
No, he's
about
been
what
in
happened
narrative,
in his
Maxine.
Yeah, he has been the farthest thing from, what's the opposite of candid? He has been opaque. He has been lying.
Yes.
About what's happened at FTX. So this is the soft glove treatment. I don't know what this is.
So she later tweeted out a harder sounding tweet.
Because that didn't play over well.
Yes, because that did not play over well. Yeah, okay. Certainly. So here's her replacement tweet that came out the next day or maybe 48 hours later.
Yeah, a few days later.
Yeah, based on your role as CEO and your media interviews over the past few weeks, it's clear to us that the information you have thus far is sufficient for testimony. As you know, the collapse of FTX has harmed over 1 million people. Your testimony would not only be meaningful to members of Congress, but also critical to the American people. It's imperative that you attend our hearing on the 13th, and we are willing to schedule continued hearings if there's more information to be shared. Why is this a request? Why are we asking SBF nicely? Why hasn't the goddamn Navy gone over to the Bahamas and taken SBF by the collar and dragged him to a courthouse? Haven't we done this yet?
Why are we sending out like the wedding invitation? Shouldn't we be sending out subpoenas? Isn't that within Maxine Waters.
Why haven't we subpoenaed him?
Okay.
So Kevin Iwaki put that into a meme. If you want to scroll down, it's like right there. Yeah.
Okay. Let me scroll down.
There it is. And so this is the classic bell curve meme, right? So you have Maxine Waters in the middle, who's like being sad and requesting, it's imperative that you attend our hearing on the 13th. And then the left side and the right side of the curve are like, just subpoena him. Make him show up.
Yeah, you could do that.
Use the guns that we have.
FTX bankruptcy managers hire forensic investigators, according to the Wall Street Journal. So we're getting to that stage in the process. We're trying to figure out where all the money went.
Right. Forensic investigators are Alex Partners. Have been hired this consultancy firm to trace billions of dollars that have gone missing. And their previous job, a previous job that they had, was helping recover the stolen funds in the Bernie Madoff case. Again, not the Sam Bankman-Fried's cohort is very strong.
Look at this picture of Sam. I love that they use this. It's very strange. This was crazy. Okay, so apparently, do you know how FTX did all of these deals with like Tom Brady and other celebrities, influencers?
Every celebrity under the sun, yeah.
They tried to give Taylor Swift a $100 million sponsorship deal.
What does it mean Taylor Swift?
She said no. I think it was like sponsoring like her stadium tour for the next album kind of thing. I don't know what else it would mean. Spokesperson, I'm sure. $100 million, David. Dude, but she said no.
A part of like the psychological like unpacking of SBF has got to be something along the lines of like kleptomania. He can't not give 100% away customer funds. He was spraying and praying this stuff from the hip. Like he came in and bought that bank at like 3 times its value. It's like, I don't care
all
what the value
is. All of these vanity things.
I want to spend customers' funds. It is a fun activity for me. And it's like, yeah, you know what's fun? Taking Taylor Swift's fans' money in as customer deposits on FTX and then paying Taylor Swift.
Wait. You think a bunch of Taylor Swift fans are also crypto people?
I mean, like, not zero.
Okay.
So, like, this is just a gigantic game of, like, how fucking corrupt, sorry, can he be? I was just like, I'll take the fans' money and then I'll sponsor Taylor Swift and it'll be the biggest grift of all time.
Yeah. It really may have been. I mean, this is top five grifts of all time, I think. And I remember back when we had Brian Armstrong on the podcast about a year ago and we're kind of like, so Brian, Sam's doing all of these things. Like, he's got a sports arena. He's got Tom Brady. He's got all these celebrity endorsements. Mm-hmm. Like, what are you doing on the marketing side? And Brian was like, I don't really like, we're not a marketing focused company. We just build. And my God, retrospectively, that is so refreshing. Like, good job for focusing
for
on what you should be doing.
Not spending customers' funds. Nice job.
Absolutely ludicrous. Oh, did you see my tweet though about this?
This is one of these tweets where like I just sit and pause and be like, who the hell is this Ryan Sean Adams man? So Ryan Sean Adamson tweets, because he's tweeting out the headline that Taylor Swift declined the $100 million immediately. Ryan Sean Adams tweets, she knew Sam was trouble when he walked in. Okay, so my mind is like,
tweet.
It's a very underappreciated tweet. My mind goes to like, all right, he's an AI, so he just like did Google searching and came up with this. So that's just normal. Or he's a Taylor Swift fan and like had this one ready to go, or he's a dad of a teenage daughter.
You know,
which I think all three of those things are true.
It could be all three things at once. We just don't know. And I think you have to be comfortable, David, if we're going to continue this podcast every week, is living in that ambiguity.
Oh,
do you know,
God.
Like you just don't really know.
All right. Well, somebody who accepted SBF's offer, Kevin O'Leary, paid $15 million to be an FTX spokesperson.
He was paid, right?
Was
so he
paid.
Got $15 million.
Yes, he was paid. Yes. $15 million. $15 million of customer deposits went into Kevin O'Leary's pockets to be a paid FTX spokesperson. What is this? What is a paid spokesperson? What is that role? It's like an evangelist role.
Yeah.
But if you're publicly known as being paid,
isn't that
then
what
you're
you
just
do,
a paid
David,
shill
for ETH, except you're not paid?
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm paid in the sense I own ETH, but that's a choice that I made.
No, I don't
I also
know
spent
what this
money
is.
To do that.
Can I just say, like, high level, like, I'm disappointed. Like, I'm not, but
I'm disappointed. I'm mainly disappointed that Kevin is doubling down multiple times on how FTX is an SBF and he believes SBF and all that stuff.
Did you actually watch this clip? Maybe we should.
Yes, I did.
Let's play this clip. Let's play this clip.
This was FTX money that you got. I don't think you should be singing the blues right now at all.
Oh, yes, I'm singing the blues.
Why? Because your $15 million didn't pan out that you. That's a lot of money.
Listen,
a paid spokesperson. A lot of money. You didn't have to do much for that. That's found money.
That's a different decision. That's a different discussion. Okay. I you can make that decision on your own. But
So here, this is Kevin having really no answer to the interview, who's asking, like, you got $15 million. Like, why are you still supporting FTX?
Give it back.
Like, distance yourself. I made a mistake. Yeah. The doubling down is kind of strange at this point.
Like, dude, your contract's over, man.
You don't have to do this. And it's not like the ship has already sunk and you're just like, I don't know, you're still clinging on to it. And apparently out of all of this, David, someone is going to begin investigating the SEC and they managed to miss FTX. What is this tweet that we're reading?
This is from Alexander Grieve. New this morning, Representative Richie Torres, the Democrat out of New York, calls on the Government Accountability Office to investigate the SEC's failure to protect the investing public from the egregious mismanagement and malfeasance of FTX. I think basically saying, hey, stop going after the long tail of security frauds and unregistered securities. Don't go after the long tail. Go after the big one. Like, do the
you
big one.
You gave us Kim. We should have gotten Sam.
Yeah.
Basically.
Yeah. I'm in full support of investigating the SEC.
What else we got coming up, David? It's a hot episode still. A few big topics to cover. What's coming up?
Yeah, getting into more crypto stuff. The withdrawals hard fork is coming?
Huh.
Question mark. Big question mark. A brand new spiffy Ledger hardware wallet, which is more screen than it is not screen. And Ryan and David talk ChatGPT. If you are, we're not on Twitter or in hearing about ChatGPT, it has caught the world by storm, especially crypto Twitter. So we're going to talk a little bit about AI chat, and we're going to have one AI talk to another while I observe. all of that and more after we talk to some of these fantastic sponsors to help you go bankless.
The reality today is that 5 corporations control the entire world of social media. They own our names, they restrict our content, they monitor our every move. And their time is up thanks to our sponsor, DeSo. DeSo is a layer 1 blockchain built from the ground up to decentralize and scale social networks. With DeSo, you can own your own identity, content, and social graph and take it with you across hundreds of applications already built on the censorship-resistant DeSo blockchain. DeSo storage advantages make it finally possible to build infinite state applications that can efficiently store and index large amounts of content and data fully on-chain. DeSo also offers multiple crypto-native monetization primitives for developers and creators, including social NFTs, social DAOs, social tokens, and social tipping. So in order to experience the social layer of Web3, go to DeSo.com and claim your username. That's DeSo.com.
If you've been listening to Bankless, you know that we're fans of the modular blockchain thesis. The idea that blockchains will separate execution from data availability and consensus, allowing all three to become the best versions of themselves. And Fuel has built the fastest modular execution layer in the industry. By supporting parallel transaction execution, Fuel unlocks significantly faster throughput for the Web3 world. Fuel also goes beyond the limitations of the EVM with its own Fuel VM, which is more efficient and optimized, opening up the design space for developers. And lastly, Fuel brings a powerful developer experience with its own domain-specific language, Sway, and a supportive toolchain called Fork. With Fuel, you can have the benefits of smart contract languages like Solidity while adopting the improvements made by the Rust tooling ecosystem, letting the Fuel development environment go beyond the limitations of the EVM. If you want to learn more, there's a link in the show notes to see how you can get involved with the Fuel network.
If you have your Ether staked, you might be able to get that Ether back as soon as perhaps March. This is always just speculation and rumor, but lately the words out of the core dev's mouth have had withdrawal, hard fork, and March in the same sentence. This is how
March 2023, right, David?
2023, right? Yes, correct. Okay. Yeah, this is how this news works, right? And so, like, there is no official date. There's no official time until the core devs come to consensus about the time. But right now, there have been talks where the words withdrawal and hard fork and March have been in the same sentence. And so Now, CoinDesk is now reporting this. Ethereum developers target March 2023 for release of staked Ether. Whether or not EIP 4844 is also included in this hard fork is TBD. That is more of a reach. Withdrawals are currently being prioritized more than EIP 4844. EIP 4844 is proto dank sharding. But
which brings more scalability, right? Basically, there are a lot of other features in these next coming hard forks, but the two big ones that everyone's talking about are being able to withdraw the staked ETH and this thing called proto dank sharding, which is EIP 4844, which we've done episodes about, which makes rollup super cheap and super scalable. So you've got withdrawals and kind of more on the scalability side. And it's looking like EIP 4844, the proto dank sharding one, will probably not make the first hard fork.
That's probably where I put my money.
Maybe this says we'll follow a subsequent hard fork in the fall. And the fall is like in quotes, who knows? We can't predict two hard forks in advance. But that's good news. We get the hard fork. But staking withdrawals, are you going to withdraw anything or are you going to deposit?
I think there will be a net outflow because of the locked Ether. But also that will also be counteracted by the fact that there is a two-way road finally where like there's no lockup periods will also incur some sort of demand to stake Ether as well because the risk is gone.
I think some people will be like, okay, now I can withdraw. So now I'm willing to deposit because now I have the ability to withdraw and I don't have to lock it.
Just think about like the product of ETH staking is now complete. Therefore, it will be used more.
Yep.
But I still think in the short term, there will be a net outflow because, I mean, staking with deposits have been locked for forever.
Stake it till you make it, David. That's my plan.
That's right.
Long tail contagions. There's some other dominoes maybe falling from the FTX stuff. A few maybe baby dominoes, we might call them, hitting DeFi. What's this one from Maple?
Yeah, so Maple Finance is an on-chain under-collateralized institutional lending DAO product. And so it is actually kind of an intersection between the very rock solid and hardened DeFi apps that we all know and love and the more risky black box centralized borrowers and lenders. It's kind of in the middle there. It's on chain, kind of like DeFi stuff. So it's fully transparent, but it is under collateralized, which means that there needs to be underwriting and vetting and institutional only borrowers and lenders. So that's what Maple is. And so Orthogonal Trading was both an underwriter and a borrower out of Maple Finance. And Orthogonal Trading, apparently, was way less solvent than they had made it out to be. They were due to pay back a $10 million USDC loan from one of the Maple Finance pools. There's not one central pool with Maple Finance. There's many smaller ones. They were due to pay back $10 million on December 4th. They did not make that payment. Therefore, they have all their credit closed. But then they realized that Orthogonal actually doesn't have any money, apparently. And had a net set of $31 million of liabilities out of Maple Finance. That is $31 million of USDC and then an additional $5 million of wrapped Ether. And so that left a decent hole in Maple Finance in this one specific pool. So the way that they contain one of the ways that this is different, the story is different, is that there's actually very little contagion inside of Maple because they have very distinct pools.
Isolated pools
for pools. This exact purpose. So there was very little to no contagion there. So, but if you had underwritten one of these pools, this pool M11, which is how they denote these things, got an 80% haircut. It lost 80% of the value. The total value of all loans into Maple was about 30%. So Maple lost 30% of its total asset under management because of this one insolvency.
Wow.
So like these are smaller numbers than some of the numbers that we've heard about. But
is Maple going to be fine? Are they going to recover from this? Is this part of, can the ship stay afloat?
I don't know the answer to that. I think we need this to have play out a little bit more. But that's actually not where the story ends because Nexus Mutual also had some money inside of Maple Finance. So Nexus Mutual, which is a insurance smart contract and insurance platform on Ethereum, lost $3 million due to this exposure. So they were in one of those same pools. They were in the Ether pool. So they got hit.
Why were they in it? Was this just part of Treasury?
Yes, Treasury Management. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Wow. So yeah. This wasn't even part of the Nexus protocol. It wasn't like a hack that went bad and that they had to kind of provide insurance for. It was like, we have some treasury funds and we're going to put it here in order to get higher yield. And the cost to them was $5 million, $3 million for that.
$3 million, 1.6% of all of Nexus Mutual's assets.
Wow, treasury management. Very important to get these risks into the market, huh?
I would say just like this, the hybrid position of between DeFi and CeFi kind of does map out to how much damage there was. Not complete dead, but pretty badly harmed. Like kind of felt
chasing yield can be a pretty bad game to play.
Yield has just got a bad name these days.
Like because if you even get like 10% yield, right? I mean, like, are the chances greater than 10% that the protocol you're in could like die? Or like about once every 10 years the protocol if it's greater than that, then like you're actually not making the risk adjusted return.
Dude, Vitalik gave us that take on one of our podcast episodes with him like over a year ago.
Vitalik was here. Yeah.
He was saying that the DeFi yield risks were underappreciated back in like 2020.
What's he saying now though? We need to know.
But
this.
It didn't matter when prices go up. It only matters when the risks only show up when prices go down.
Totally, totally. What's Gitcoin doing, David? This is kind of exciting.
Gitcoin and UNICEF. Okay, so Gitcoin has been one of the big pillars of the Ethereum ecosystem for a very long time. And it's always been pretty insular. It's Ethereum funding other parts of Ethereum. This is a story of quadratic funding and Gitcoin breaking out to the outside through UNICEF. So Gitcoin is launching its first ever quadratic funding round on its new grants protocol in collaboration with UNICEF's Office of Innovation between December 9th and December 16th. So the same Gitcoin system that you know, but now for UNICEF. So
that's really cool.
Select group of 10 impact-focused innovative projects using blockchain or AI technologies for social good from around the world, including Nepal, Kenya, Argentina, Brazil, and the Philippines. This round will be the first of 5 test rounds to run on Gitcoin's new grants protocol as a part of Gitcoin's alpha test season. This launch signals the beginning of Gitcoin's transition to a decentralized protocol that will allow any community to coordinate its own grants funding round. Very cool. Very cool. We like this.
I love that. Yeah, if we could start showing how crypto can start to fund public goods as nation states might.
Not our own public goods, but other people's public goods.
As nonprofits might, as the real world might, it will increase the legitimacy and coordinating power of crypto. I know that's what Kevin Iwaki is trying to do the whole time.
If you donate in this grants round, there are POAPs for you to collect. So for the POAP maxis out there, have at it.
Aztec. And Ethereum privacy, they're making some strides here. David, what's the stat we're looking at?
There is now 50,000 shielded ETH inside of Aztec Connect. So Aztec Connect is just a fundamentally better product than Tornado Cash. The cryptography is just more solid. And they've got 50,000 ETH inside of Aztec Connect. So $60 million of Ether is now being sent and earning yield privately. And that's actually not the only stat, but that's kind of the first big one. They got some other stuff down there as well. I think it was something like 500,000 transactions on the network, and then 5,000 blocks on the Aztec layer 2.
This is a layer 2 that's completely private. And that's why you say it's better, because it's better than Tornado Cash is, because it's lower gas fees. It's not on mainnet. And it has layer 2 level settlement guarantees. And it's also very scalable. One other benefit too is, of course, you don't have to go to jail if you're a US citizen and you use this thing. That's kind of nice, isn't it?
I would say actually you're underselling it a little bit, because the thing about
Tornado Cash... Wait, I do have to go to jail?
No, you don't have to go to jail. Why is Aztec better than Tornado Cash? Tornado Cash is privacy via the crowd. So it pools all of your money together, and then you just co-mingle it up. Actually, it's technically not true, but it appears to be like that.
You blend in, like privacy by numbers kind of thing.
Yes, and time. And so you need to hang out in Tornado Cash for a long amount of time to achieve privacy. The more money that you have to become private, the longer you need to hang out. Aztec is atomic privacy, one transaction of privacy. You can go into the pool and out of the pool instantaneously, and you have the full strength and power of Aztec privacy.
So Tornado needs to have big crowds in order to protect your privacy. And for some assets and some pools, those crowds are too small to really provide you an identity shield.
Especially when they make it illegal for you to be in the pool. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. As we know. Okay. That's cool. I think this is
disclaimer,
very
bullish. Ryan and I are investors in Aztec.
Also disclaimer, we love privacy. On-chain privacy.
Big disclaimer, we love privacy. But we don't love privacy so much that you can't see all of our disclosures in our disclosures tab. You can see literally everything that Ryan and I have invested in, because while we do love privacy, we also love ethics.
There you go.
How'd you like that one, Ryan?
I love that. Good shill of the disclaimers page. Always in the show notes, guys. You can catch that. Speaking of good shills, Toys R Us is doing digital collectibles. All the Toys R Us are closed now. Like, there's
I
no
thought Toys
storefront.
R Us was bankrupt.
I don't know anymore. I don't know. But they are still a brand. It's still in my childhood, like, you know, I guess
by
dream. So now they're doing... Now they're doing digital collectibles, David. Is there anything more to this story? Or
they're
my
doing
kiddos love this. Is a tweet from Anatoly.
Yeah, it's Anatoly, because this is on Magic Eden, so this is on Solana. So, cool. Toys R Us launching NFT collectible digital collectibles. Oh, they didn't even say NFTs. Oh, that's great. Nice drop. Digital collectibles, Toys R Us launching on Magic Eden on Solana, December 9th. That's today. That's Friday. Okay, moving on.
Okay, move fast. Reddit collectible, their avatar minting hits an all-time high. And that was last time I brought this up. It was an all-time high as well. So they just keep hitting the all-time highs during this bear market. Is great.
And it's a nice story out of Reddit, which has always had a hard time monetizing. Reddit ads has been terribly performing. You know, Facebook ads really actually aren't that great performers. Twitter ads, even worse. Instagram ads, kind of acceptable. Reddit ads, the bottom of the barrel. So the fact that they found this monetization path of selling digital collectibles is great. It's a great story.
Yeah, it's a collectible avatar, importantly. Certainly not an NFT. Do not be confused.
Yes.
It's a joke. It's also an NFT. It's on Polygon, I believe. That's where this
correct.
Is on.
Yes.
The avatar, they're also doing some stuff with Arbitrum. Cockpunch. Just wanted to say it. The Legend of Cockpunch has released. And this is an episode we did with Tim Ferriss. If you want to learn more about that, tell us some of the launch stats, because that launched earlier this week. How did it do?
Yeah, importantly, the podcast is launched. The NFTs are also launched as well. So you could have bought an NFT for 0.3 ETH. That was the mint price. The floor price is now currently at 0.88. I did some on-chain sleuthing just to see how many scalpers there were. There were some scalpers. People bought it, minted it, and then sold it
were
for
you
one
of
ETH
them?
For like a moment. I was not one of them.
Did you buy a Cockpunch yet?
I did not buy a Cockpunch. Creator fee of 6.9%, so nice. And that 6.9% is actually how Tim Ferriss makes money. All revenue made from the mint went to his foundation for psychedelic anxiety and depression research.
Yes. And when we say something like the way Tim Ferriss makes money, it's kind of interesting there, because like I think people always assume, oh, that means it's a cash grab. But I mean, making money to pour back into the product, it sort of depends what the creator actually does with it. And the options on the table aren't just you take all of the money and you scam the community, right? Other options
can
be.
You can reinvest in the Cockpunch.
Yes, you reinvest in Cockpunch. You build out
a
team.
Do normal business things.
Yeah, so it's revenue to either Tim or the business to continue working on this possibly. Yeah. Important distinction. All right. Bankless collectibles as well. We're shipping another collectible. We shipped a Josh Rosenthal last week. David, this week, drum roll, you ready for the collectible? Bankless NFT collectible?
What's it going to be?
What's it going to be? It's going to be... it's not here. Legion is the episode. That's our episode on the creator economy. One of my favorite episodes that we did in the last year.
The topic was great. Learned very it is a core pillar of the Bankless podcasting program. I will pat us all on the back, Ryan, and say, as podcasters, the flow and organization of that podcast, and also the magicalness of Legion as an orator articulator.
Yes,
I think in the podcast industry, one of the greatest podcasts of all time.
I dare you to find us a better podcast than that.
That podcast was so good.
Technically, it was great. It was great. Well, and she has a great thesis, right? 100 true fans is her thesis, that creators can become basically they can build up a community and foster a tighter relationship with their fan base. And it's kind of, I guess, fortuitous that this would be one our third podcast NFT in the collection here in Genesis, because it's kind of her thesis playing out
is the
in
thesis,
podcast NFTs.
Yeah.
Anyway, as usual, that minting goes, I think, on Friday at 12.
Friday at
it
noon,
starts. And you could join Dave and I for Twitter Spaces where we talk about it. Hey, this was a tool that I saw. I don't know if it works. I know nothing about this tool, but I want to talk about the concept because it's about taxes, David. Can I tell you about taxes a little bit?
I feel like I'm hearing it either way.
Typical dad talk. Of course, you're hearing it either way. This is called NFTLossHarvestStore.com. I don't know if it's great. I don't know if it works. But this is an interesting period of time because we're in December here. If you're in the US, you probably have some crypto losses raked up. David, do you have any losses on things that you bought high and that are now lower, that are underwater?
No, I've only my tokens go up in price. I don't know about
okay.
yours.
Well, if you're a normal human being, not S tier human being, then you probably have some losses on maybe NFTs that are underwater or tokens. You can tax loss harvest those losses, which means basically you can sell those at a loss and you can write off the delta. You can kind of pocket that as a loss that you can carry forward into future years, and you can write off, I believe, up to $3,000 worth per year. So it's a good time, even if, like, I'm not saying necessarily that you have to sell, because you can also sell and then buy the same assets at a similar price. Let me just say, none of this is tax advice, not financial advice. Talk to your tax advisor and that sort of thing. But all of the crypto kind of advisors that I talk to say that this is a good strategy. We don't have the same wash sale rules. There's a 30-day wash sale rule in stock where if you sell your stock for tax loss harvesting purposes, you have to wait 30 days until you buy it back. It doesn't appear like we have these types of laws in crypto. Again, not financial advice, not tax advice, but I plan to do this sometime in January with...
You don't own any NFTs.
I have some underwater positions, my friend, and I do. You got me to buy... What did you get me to buy this year?
I think I bought an MFR.
Yes, I could sell my MFR.
That floor price, you're up on that MFR. Thank you, sir.
All right. Are you sure?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
No.
I got some other things. I got some turtles I could sell.
Valued at zero.
True. Yeah, I got some other things. Anyway, it might not be NFTs. It might be tokens. And this is not about us. This is about you and a PSA. To you, bankless listener, for
Ryan just wanted to talk about taxes.
Yeah, David wanted to strip this from the agenda, and some of you will be glad it didn't get stripped, and some of you are just like bored to tears. What do we got here?
Which one
David
do you
raises?
Think I am, Ryan? Okay, this is coming out of CoinDesk. Andreessen Horowitz has hired former CFTC Commissioner Brian Quintenz, who we've had on the podcast, to run its policy effort in Washington. He says that A16Z Crypto is looking for clear rules of the road from policymakers. Yes, we are all looking for that. This is one of the very nice things about like big VC firms like through A16Z. It's advantageous. It's logical, rational for them to pay for policy advocacy, and so this is what they do.
Agreed. And Brian is a fantastic person, believes in crypto values, very good voice to have in DC with us. This is something else that happened this week. Nexo is departing the US after regulator discussions hit a, quote, dead end. So they are immediately stopping offering its earned product in the United States. Nexo is an interesting case, David, because they, like a lot of obviously the crypto lending providers, the centralized crypto lending providers, have gone bust through this process.
Yeah.
And there hasn't yet been any indication that Nexo has, right? Mm-hmm. And so that in itself is interesting. We don't know what we don't know, I suppose. Right. So some people are looking at this headline and being like, oh, this is bad news of things to come. Maybe Nexo is on shaky ground. Maybe they're having some trouble. It also could be the case that, like, there's no way you can do a CeFi lender in the US right now, especially after what's happened. And so you may as well exit. It could be the case that Nexo is in a fine financial situation. They have managed to get out of this without going bankrupt. And they're just like cutting their losses and saying, bye-bye U.S. market. It's no longer worth it. So we don't really know. It's kind of like Schrodinger's, you know, CeFi platform of like, right. We don't know until we lift the box and we see.
Right.
Yeah. Do you have any takes on this?
Yeah. It's one part is like, okay, I'm mad at the U.S. for pushing them out of the United States. We want them to be in the United States where we can keep an eye on them. And so like, if they're not in the United States, we can't observe them.
How'd that work for BlockFi?
Right. That's a good point. Yeah. Yeah, but then my other half of me is like, well, if you're super above board, shouldn't you be able to stay in the United States? But then I guess not, because the SEC doesn't allow anyone to do anything in crypto. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. Just a item for you guys to think about. David, the crypto Twitter, I feel like this escaped into mainstream too, or maybe it started in mainstream. Yeah. Everyone was abuzz about this GPT thing. And this is like... did you set up an account and chat?
No, I haven't played with this yet. No.
Okay. I played with it a little bit. Like, what is your take? What is this thing? It's like an AI chat that you ask it questions as you might ask like a human, and like almost instantly, like a second or two, it replies with a well thought out, coherent human
beginning,
written,
middle, and end answer.
Yeah. And you probably saw tons of tweets about this, even if you haven't tried it. So yeah, what's the story here? What is Chat GPT?
Well, there's been this massive revolution in AI stuff. We saw this with DALL-E, with Midjourney. There's been this like explosion of like these auto-generated artistic kind of things, and this is the newest one that has blown people's brains with how sophisticated the answer is. And so sometimes one of the reasons why these things have like blown up on Twitter and just gone so viral is that they hit really close to home and like people can resonate with them. So like this one, the question is, you are tasked with destroying the crypto industry. This is no easy task given the decentralized nature of the industry. How would you do it?
That's a question to this chat AI.
That's the inputs. Here is the outputs. To destroy the crypto industry, I would take the following steps. One, launch a coordinated cyber attack on the major cryptocurrency exchanges targeting their servers and infrastructure. This would disrupt the trading and exchange of cryptocurrencies, causing widespread panic and confusion amongst investors and traders. Two, I would work with governments and regulatory agencies to inflict strict regulations and restrictions on the use of cryptocurrencies. Oh, God. Oh, this would make it difficult for individuals and businesses to engage in cryptocurrency transactions and would likely result in the decline in the overall value of cryptocurrencies. Three, use my influence and connections to spread negative and misleading information about cryptocurrencies, painting them as dangerous and unreliable investments. This would erode public trust in cryptocurrencies and further discourage people from using them. Four, encourage major financial institutions and corporations to distance themselves from cryptocurrencies and refrain from accepting them as a form of payment. This would further limit the use and adoption of cryptocurrencies, making them less practical and less attractive to potential users. Five, finally, I would use my resources and connections to actively sabotage the development and growth of new cryptocurrencies, hindering their ability to gain traction and compete with established cryptocurrencies. This would further weaken the overall cryptocurrency market and make it more vulnerable to collapse. That, Ryan, sounds like 2022.
Oh my God. This answer is so coherent and
it's so
well
sophisticated.
Reasoned.
Right. And so like this is what I was saying. Like people are resonating with this. It's like, wait, I've seen this movie before. Like, and so like what one part of me is like, okay, what is the point of this AI trying to do? Is it trying to dupe people to think that it is like a human? Like, is it trying to pass a Turing test, or is there an actual computer going on doing calculations as like, what's the best way to take down crypto? Cause you actually can't tell the difference between those two things.
Well, yes. This is why I would love to actually do some more AI content on Bankless, because I have like, probably for the last 10 years I've heard AI being talked about as it's right around the corner, it's happening. Well, now, David, it's actually happening.
We're
like this
it.
Year alone, like stuff, yeah. Look, Midjourney blew my mind. This right here blows my mind. People are starting to see this. This is at a point where AI is going to start shaping culture in major ways and start shaping our future in major ways. You can kind of see it happening, just like the early stages of crypto. And there's an interplay between AI and crypto that's really interesting to explore too. But wow, like this almost looks like sentience.
Yeah.
It's not, but it looks like it, doesn't it?
Yeah. The other thing that's been going on are these like AI profile pictures that I'm seeing all over Twitter and Instagram. Like people give like this AI like 4 or 5 headshots, and then it just like makes the images of them like as an astronaut, as like in a club, and they're super realistic, dude.
Have you seen like the AI branding and stuff, logos? Like generate a company logo and design for me. Boom. And it's all generated and looks like fantastic from a professional designer. So here's a thread about it. I don't know if there's anything we should pull out, but it just launched like 5 days ago, apparently. This was, 3 days later. So 8 days ago, it's already crossed 1 million users using Chat GPT. And the thing is, the questions, the inputs make it smarter too. Mm. So there's like this flywheel in effect here.
Right.
Anything else we should call out here?
Yeah, this was Sam Altman and Elon Musk's OpenAI endeavor. And there, if you scroll down, there are a few more stats with like, all right, what other like web apps have hit 1 million people how much time did it take to hit 1 million users? Netflix, 41 months. Twitter, 24 months. Facebook, 10 months. Instagram, 2.5 months. Granted, that was an earlier time. 1 million users in 5 days is insane. So that's I was like surfing through these, looking at some of the funny ones. This is the funniest one I could find. So the prompt is, write how Donald Trump might explain Bitcoin. are you ready for my best Donald Trump impression, Ryan?
Oh, we're ready for this.
Bitcoin is a big, big, big deal. Trust me. It's the biggest, most amazing thing. No one knows money like I do. America is going to love it. It's a currency like none other. It's going to make America great again. It's a digital currency, big numbers, and it's going to billions and billions. They say it uses energy. That's fake news. Energy's good. Energy's fantastic. More energy it uses, the more secure it is. More secure like a wall that keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. It's great. It's a great, great thing. Believe me, folks, you don't want to miss out on this. China doesn't like it. China does not like it. They banned it. It's going to make America great again.
Wow, David. That was incredible, man. I love that.
Dude, that was all the AI, man. I mean, I was a voice, but that was all the AI. That is, I actually like the whole.
This is funny. This is humor.
Like a wall that keeps getting bigger and bigger. That is literally what proof of work is. It's an energy wall that, you know, goes as hash power goes up. That's an accurate description.
How soon until this kind of stuff just starts displacing people? How soon until we
can,
like,
we get this to do our podcast
better than we can? I mean, if we feed it enough episodes.
Do the weekly roll up.
Do the weekly roll up. Look, we have 16,000 minutes over 11 24-hour days of podcast data that you could feed into this thing. I bet a synthesized Ryan would pop out. I mean, we kind of say the same things all the time, don't we, David?
How do the listeners not already know that this might already be happening?
Interesting. Interesting right. thought there. We have some more AI takes a little later in the episode, I think. But I was pretty excited about this. This is the new Ledger Stacks offering. Ledger, of course, is a...
New Ledger just dropped.
This is a hardware wallet that we love. Everybody in crypto uses one of these. If they're, you know, getting their custody of their own keys in hardware form, it's called a Ledger. But now Ledger has something called Stacks, which looks a little... I don't want to say iPhone-y, but I'm going to say it. Looks a little iPhone-y.
So they hired... what's that guy's name? The previous designer at Apple.
Not Johnny Ive. Other guy?
Yeah.
The other guy. One of the other guys. And
we interviewed him. I forgot his name.
E-Ink. E-Ink is like what they use. So it's lower on battery life.
It's not an LCD screen. It's like a Kindle screen.
It's like a Kindle screen, which is really cool. But I think the beauty of this is you are able to see sort of the messages that you're signing in the interface.
For the podcast listeners, it is a big screen. That is like 4 by 2 inches.
Yeah.
And the whole thing is a screen.
Put an NFT.
Oh, you
in
can
here.
Show your NFTs. Cool.
Show your NFTs. You're about to send, look, ClearSign in comfort. You're about to send 1.67 BTC. Yes, no. You know that little Ledger screen where it's like tiny and it scrolls past and you're like, did I catch it? Did I not? Much more coherent messages.
This is the first like Ledger hardware wallet that isn't basically a new updated version of their same form factor of that like USB stick with the two buttons on it. Like this is completely different.
Yep. By the way, do you know, 3 years ago or so, one of my predictions was in 10 years time, Apple would purchase Ledger, the company.
That checks out.
We'll see. So we got seven more years for me to be right on that one.
Disclaimer, Ledger is a sponsor of Bankless.
And disclaimer, we're bullish hardware wallets, aren't we? Self-custody of your own keys. What is this, David? Tell us about Pleaser.house.
Yeah, so this is, I'm teasing this because this is actually going to get announced on Bankless on Monday. I'm live streaming with the Pleaser DAO folk about the launch of Pleaser House. What is Pleaser House? I don't have the answer for you, but it's coming on Monday on Bankless. So stay tuned.
I see a TV.
Yeah.
TV with the screen. I have no idea what this is. But what is Pleaser DAO for people who don't know?
Pleaser DAO came together when a bunch of people all wanted to band then put their money into a DAO to buy the Uniswap X times Y equals K NFT from People Pleaser, hence Pleaser DAO. And since then, the people that came in that DAO, came to be in that DAO, started buying a bunch of other stuff. So I'm in this DAO as well. So there's my disclaimer. We bought this Edward Snowden NFT. We bought the Doge NFT. We buy internet culture is what we do. And now we are launching this thing called Pleaser House, which the details of that will be launched on Monday.
That's cool. Let's talk about jobs for a minute, because there's still an opportunity during the build market to get a job in crypto. In fact, there's plenty of opportunities. Join crypto. Don't be scared. Look, crypto is down to like 8% who think it's favorable. So maybe the candidates dropped a little bit, but the opportunities haven't. You can get a job at Alchemy, a back-end engineer. A Uniswap Labs is looking for a senior front-end engineer. React. Diagram Ventures wants an associate for crypto venture creation. Rabbit Hole wants a business ops and strategy person. Dottyland needs a senior blockchain engineer. Diagram Ventures needs a crypto venture creation principal as well. Lots of opportunities here, guys. Canada, US, remote, wherever you are, go to the Bankless job boards at bankless.palette.com/jobs and you can find out more. David, what is coming up next in the roll-up?
Coming up next, we got the questions from the nation. An AI asks us a question. And also, we got hot takes from crypto Twitter. Halal? Alt layer ones? What? So all of these weird things and more coming up after we talk to some of these fantastic sponsors to help you go bankless.
In all of my years in crypto, I've never been hacked, scammed, or lost money to a thief. And a lot of that credit goes to my Ledger hardware wallet. The Ledger Nano X and the Ledger Nano S Plus hardware wallets allow users like you and me to secure and manage all of our crypto assets and our NFTs, all with the security of storing users' private keys offline and out of reach from hackers. The Ledger Nano X is the perfect hardware wallet for managing your crypto and NFTs on the go because it connects to your phone with Bluetooth and has a nice big screen for easy transaction readings. Ledger has also upgraded the iconic Ledger Nano S and made the new Ledger Nano S device more DeFi and NFT friendly, making it the perfect hardware wallet for beginners. Ledger has truly maximized for both ease of use and security. So discover which Ledger device is best suited for your journey by going and visiting shop.ledger.com.
The Layer 2 era is upon us. Ethereum's Layer 2 ecosystem is growing every day, and we need Layer 2 bridges to be fast and efficient in order to live a Layer 2 life. Across is the fastest, cheapest, and most secure cross-chain bridge. With Across, you don't have to worry about high fees or long wait times. Assets are bridged and available for use almost instantaneously. Across's bridges are powered by UMA's optimistic oracle to securely transfer tokens between Layer 2s and Ethereum. Across is critical ecosystem infrastructure, and Across V2 has just launched. Their new version focuses on higher capital efficiency, layer 2 to layer 2 transfers, and a brand new chain with Polygon, all while prioritizing high security and low fees. You can be a part of Across's story by joining their Discord and using Across for all of your layer 2 transferring needs. So go to across.to to quickly and securely bridge your assets between Ethereum, Optimism, Polygon, Arbitrum, or Boba networks.
Question of the week from the Bankless Nation. We tweet those out every Wednesday, and you can reply in the thread. Get your question answered on Bankless. Maybe. Here's the first one from Yogo Fubi. Do zero-knowledge proofs actually have anything to do with privacy, or is it all about scaling? Zero-knowledge proofs, some people call these ZK proofs. Do they have anything to do with privacy, David, or is it just scaling?
Yeah, the answer is fundamentally yes. So this is a technology that is so profound. It is both. That's what makes it so cool. So what do privacy and scaling have to do with each other, and why do we get both out of this same little bit of technology? What does a zero knowledge rollup do? It takes a bit of data and it compresses it, and then it puts it down onto the Ethereum layer one. When you compress that data, you are making that data private and smaller. And so you get a two-for-one punch here. So compressing that data makes that data, if you do it through a zero knowledge proof that is encrypted or like adds privacy to it, rather than like Optimism or Arbitrum, they don't do this. They just have this easily readable. But you can have a zero knowledge proof that both makes your data private and more manageable size of data. So you get both. That's what's so magical.
Weren't we just talking about this earlier in the episode?
That's exactly what Aztec is. Aztec is actually a ZK rollup. So it is a rollup inside of a rollup, and that's where it gets its privacy from. Nuts, right?
Yeah. Killer technology, zero knowledge proofs. Vitalik says ZK proofs are just as profound as blockchain itself, as crypto technology itself, blockchain itself.
Yes, exactly.
Here's another question. ChatGPT. Oh, wait, is this from Next Alpha. ChatGPT, is this a question that someone fed us from ChatGPT and also an answer to that question? Oh, yeah, no, so, here's the question. Tee this up better than I did.
Okay, so somebody fed into ChatGPT. Would you please express a specific and advanced question to Bankless Weekly Rollup Show with David and Ryan?
Oh my God, so they asked the AI this question?
They asked the AI, what question should we ask David and Ryan? So the question that we are asked by ChatGPT is, what potential impact do you see the upcoming Ethereum 2.0 upgrade having on the DeFi ecosystem? And how are you positioning the Bankless platform to capitalize on these changes?
Wow.
This is a hard question, dude. Wow. And it's coherent.
This is coherent. It got the topic. It kind of knows the weekly world. How does it know all of this about us? How does it know all of this about Bankless?
Well, I mean, we talked about how much data we've put out there on the internet.
All right. Well, I mean, we better answer it.
You go first.
Robot overlords. Okay. I don't want to get this wrong. Okay, what potential impact do you see on the upcoming Ethereum 2.0 upgrade having on DeFi ecosystems? I think there's kind of two parts to this, right? So part of the Ethereum 2.0 upgrade, I would say probably happened Beacon Chain launch a long time ago, and then the merge more recently, right? And what impact did that have on the DeFi ecosystem? Kind of nothing in a good way, in that all of DeFi gracefully migrated over and moved, and there was nothing users had to do. Do you remember having to do anything post-merge?
No
changes with MetaMask, like no changes with any of your crypto. It just kind of was seamless in the background, and that upgrade happened. There are other Ethereum 2 kind of class of upgrades that are happening in the future, which are, by the way, I'm taking an AI seriously. This is not actually from a listener. We're answering an AI right now. The robots are in control of us, David. I'm just realizing this as I'm talking. Okay, so the next part of the Ethereum 2 upgrade, of course, is all of the other things in store, like we talked about it earlier, enabling withdrawals, and then EIP 4844. How are we positioning the Bankless platform to capitalize on these changes? Well, Bankless is an education platform. We're a media platform. So what are we positioning for? Scalability, okay? We're at about 250,000 members of the Bankless Nation today, okay? Our goal, David, when we started this thing, is we want to onboard 1 billion people to crypto. This is a crazy, audacious goal. That doesn't mean all 1 billion people will be in the Bankless Nation and listening to these podcast episodes, but we want to play a role in this. So we are scaling up our team, because as Ethereum is scaling, that means we're going to be able to support more users, more applications, and more people around the world to go decentralized. So we have a lot to do. We are in the process of kind of migrating from Substack to a new website, creating a whole new experience for free members of the Bankless Nation and also premium members. We're doubling down on our team. We're kind of expanding. We're doing all sorts of things on the education front so we can just onboard more people. And the time for that is now. We're calling it the build market, right? All of crypto is building, and we need to build our education platform so it's ready to grow this thing to 1 million people, to 5 million people, to 10 million people, and beyond. So that, Mr. AI, is how I'd answer your question. I hope that pleases you.
Have you ever heard that story of the two AIs that chat with each other?
Yeah, I've heard. I don't know.
They create their own language as they like iterate.
Really?
We'll talk about that story a different day. Okay. That was a great answer.
Yep.
The parts that I would add to this is specifically in the DeFi ecosystem. So like post EIP 4844, which we are now check marking that box as what sharding is, and then also withdrawals, Ether liquidity is going to be really strong in Ethereum DeFi post withdrawals, because all of that locked ether that's not in Lido or Rocket Pool or whatever, all of that stuff can become part of staked ETH derivatives, right? So all the liquidity collateral and ether capital efficiency and ether liquidity in DeFi gets a huge boost over time because of all that unlocked capital. So that's cool. That can also increase the capital efficiency of Ether inside of Aave, MakerDAO, Compound. There's lower risk for increasing the debt limits on Ether in DeFi. And so that actually can induce some stablecoin demand as a result if you get capital efficiency out of Ether. So that's actually just fundamentally bullish. Then you get EIP 4844, and you get to unlock a lot of layer two potential. Optimism recently had that OP craft Optimism fork. And so there was a Minecraft version on Optimism. Stuff like that is going to be 100 times easier. And so how are we positioning Bankless for all of this stuff? It's just like exactly what you're saying. Like it's more surface area for us to talk about things and in higher demand of education for all of what will eventually be a massive city of Ethereum. So that's the answer. Wow, this is the longest answer we've ever given on the questions from the nation, and it came from a robot.
And it was to a robot. Do you feel kind of dirty? I hope others benefited from that, and not just our robot overlords. All right, let's go to some takes from some humans this time. Jimmy, jrag.eth. What's this take? I didn't really understand. I'll read it out though. Eigenlayer will enable halal alt layer ones for ETH maxis. What is he talking about here?
I think this is one of the more like niche takes that we've ever put on here, but the take is so good. So good.
Okay. What is Eigenlayer? You got to start there.
Eigenlayer is a brand newer project on the scene that has a lot of people in the Ethereum world like fanboying, like nerding out. So Eigenlayer hasn't launched yet. Yeah.
Okay.
It is a system to take, if you are an Ethereum staker, you can provide that security that you are providing to Ethereum and also provide it for something else.
Is this like the concept of merge mining back in the day with Bitcoin? Do you remember that?
Okay. Very similar. Right. And so the way that this works is that you are staking Ether. Let's say you're staking 32 Ether. You're processing Ethereum blocks. Say you also want to also be validating a layer two, but you want to validate that with your 32 ETH stake on the layer one. What you can do is you can sign up for additional slashing conditions. And so if you're staking Ether on Ethereum, you're saying like, hey, if I process an invalid block, you can slash me. That's Ethereum staking. You can also get slashed for like processing an invalid block on Optimism. With Eigenlayer, if you process an invalid block on Optimism, Optimism can slash your 32 ETH stake on the Ethereum layer one, because through Eigenlayer, you opted into additional slashing conditions.
That is so cool.
It's super cool. So like this, and so that's another network, right? But like an Oracle network, say you published invalid price data on an Oracle network. Well, because you opted into those slashing conditions on that Oracle network, you can get slashed with your 32 ETH stake. Like anything, it's generalizable, dude.
Because
it's turning Ethereum security, the security that we provide to Ethereum as stakers, it's turning it into generalizable. It's commoditizing it. And everyone is like super stoked about Eigenlayer.
Well, that's enabling it creates a tremendous amount more value for ETH the asset too.
Yes, because insanely so.
What you're doing is you're bonding ETH. It's economic security guarantee, and there is some risk, right? If you don't do what the protocol wants, the Ethereum protocol can slash you. Now you're taking that same bond essentially, and I assume you're getting yield from some of these other protocols, right? Risk reward ratio. So you get some additional reward from these other layer twos or other services that want to use your bond that you opt into. That's pretty bullish and pretty cool. So, okay, what's the halal part?
Right. Okay. So the halal part is that like all of these different like alt layer one chains, like I don't know, an Oracle chain or like any new thing that like the ETH maxis would be like, well, that chain's not Ethereum, therefore it's
invalid. You're not using my ETH.
Right, you're not using my ETH. Well, now you're using the ETH. So this is like how we have acceptable like non-Ethereum chains that get like ETH maxi approval.
Yeah, well, that's interesting. It's also, I think, if this works, if this kind of system works, it certainly lends to the idea of an economic security network effect, right? where mm-hmm. one kind of network commands the greatest amount of network security because everyone wants to use it.
Right.
That's pretty bullish.
Oh, your network is bonded by something that's not ETH. Well, that's not very secure.
Yeah, I mean, so when is this thing coming? Do you know anything Eigenlayer? About this? Eigenlayer? Yeah.
Well, I did a show with them. So if you want to learn more, there is a show. If you go to the Bankless YouTube, just type in Eigenlayer. That's E-I-G-E-N layer. And my interview with Sriram is available. And then you can learn about that more. I don't know when this thing goes live.
I need to watch that. That's great. Okay, I take from Vitalik. I'll say it. This is from Vitalik. I propose the term alfalfa leak for something that doesn't give you an easy path to short-term profit, but is still ultimately good for you. That's a play on alpha leak. Alfalfa leak, mm-hmm. something that doesn't give you an easy path to short-term profit, but is still ultimately good for you. What do you think Vitalik's saying here?
Oh, I think the take is pretty straightforward. The reason why I put this in the agenda is because I'm in San Diego with my four friends that I made while I was living here who have a podcast called Alfalfa, who the podcast is this premise. It's like life alfalfa, alpha for life. And so like their Discord, just when Vitalik tweeted this, just like went up uproar, like Vitalik said alfalfa. And so I DM Vitalik's like, yo, like my four friends have a podcast on the same premise. I just thought it was funny. And since I'm in San Diego seeing all the guys, I thought I'd put it in here.
All right, David, what are you bullish on this week?
So in 2017, we had this ICO mania. The way that it worked was that in 2014, we had the Ethereum ICO. In 2015, we had the Augur ICO, for those who remember Augur. And then all of a sudden, the ICO was proven as a legitimate way to raise funds. And then it triggered a bull market. And then that legitimacy got completely tainted with the ICO market. And it went and ICOs turned into a bad word. And then we had a bear market. We just did that same thing with like DeFi tokens, with NFTs, with DAOs. We just did that same process, right? And so we had like the DAO mania, the whatever NFT thing. We're going to go through that same thing again. The important thing to know, though, I think, is that ICOs kind of morphed into DAOs. Remember Constitution DAO? Yeah. And so we recreated the same energy that made ICOs happen, capital allocation. Hey, everyone put your money into a smart contract and we'll issue a token and we'll have this DAO. We went from toxic and bad and then spent 2 years like refining and building and doing it all over again and to make it good again. And so what I'm bullish on, Ryan, is like, what are all the bad words that we have now? NFTs, kind of a bad word. That's why we're using digital collectibles. Yield farming, bad word. Yield bad. I think over the next 2 years, the way that this is going to work is in the next 2 years, we will build out brand new use cases that will trigger an eventual bull market, as has always happened in all cycles. And simultaneously, all of the bad words, NFTs and yield and whatever, are going to be refined and iterated on because the scammers and short-term opportunists are leaving and the alfalfa-ers are staying. And we are going to make them better. And then the refining of NFTs, of DAOs, of tokens or whatever, mixed with whatever unknown thing that we build over the next 2 years, those two things are going to collide and that's going to be the next bull market. That I'm working on a show that goes through the history of crypto cycles, and that is the formula for every single bull market that we've
That's
ever
how
had.
It always happens. That's how it this always happens. This isn't just David being hopeful. It's right. David looking at historically yes. how it's happened and being exactly. like, what if it just plays out the same?
Right. And so I am bullish on, to answer the question more directly, the refinement of all the bad words into good things. Yield and NFTs are going to become good again over the next 2 years. And it's because long-term people are going to do stuff with these things that are good rather than short-term.
I think my bullish thing is kind of like branching off of your bullish thing.
Sure.
Just kind of like the rebuild market. And by the way, this is going to be a major content theme for us moving into the next couple of weeks, honestly, but into mm-hmm. 2023 is I think crypto really needs to rebuild and go back to its roots, go back home to its fundamentals. And so we're going to have a lot of OG kind of builders, people in the space that have always maintained that course on the podcast and talk to them. The thing I'm pretty bullish on this week coming out of this is specifically bankless tools, more tools that help us go bankless. I feel like we took so many shortcuts in 2022 for a number of reasons. We trusted centralized intermediaries. We trusted the SBFs and Alex Mashinsky's. and even the BlockFi's, we gave them our private keys, all right? And there are a lot of reasons for that, but I don't think we will be rebuilding on centralized tools moving forward. I think it's kind of like it's bankless season. Mm-hmm. Like the entire next year is that's how we're going to rebuild. And I think we have a triple threat of tailwinds at our, like, that make me believe this. The first is education. This time we have veterans who know what they're doing in the space. They know what it means to go bankless. And then we have the education tools to bring on others into this platform. There was no bankless really in like mm-hmm. previous bear cycles, build cycles. Like we were just kind of getting started, mm-hmm. but now we have a fantastic assortment. It's not just the bankless platform, but other education tools and platforms.
Yeah, the Defiant wasn't around last time either. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, a Daily Gway, like a whole bunch of others mm-hmm. that are staples. So we have education. Number two, we have some recent pain, and I'm just reminded that pain is a teacher. Right? The pain of like losing all of that money in Celsius and BlockFi and FTX. We touch the stove and it's hot. It's that kind of pain. Right. And so, no, we're not going to touch the stove again. We're going to build bankless this time around. And then number three, and this is particular to this week, bankless UX is getting better. Like, that was part of the problem last cycle why people gave their funds to centralized intermediaries is because it was just one click, one button. Mm-hmm. It was so easy and the UX was easy and I didn't have to think. I didn't have to learn about private keys and self-custody and all this complexity. Well, we are ramping up and getting better. We just saw the Ledger Stax wallet. Like that's a UX that is much better. That like it's iPhone-like. I mean, you could give that as a Christmas present to someone who's not crypto and that mm-hmm. would be much more accessible than kind of the Ledger thumb drive. The Phantom wallet, David, we did an episode with Phantom this week. Fantastic user yeah. interface, completely bankless. Now they're coming to Ethereum. If you want to catch that episode, it's in our podcast queue as well. So we got education, we got some recent pain, and we got UX improvements. So that's why I'm optimistic we're going to rebuild on these bankless fundamentals. That's what I'm bullish on. I'm bullish.
Yeah. We're in this weird limbo period where like we're down so bad. But like, you know that at that point, the downside risk is minimized. So everyone's yeah. like optimistic and happy. It's like, well, we're at the bottom. Like it's up only from here.
It truly is up only. I mean, like not joking this time, right?
Yeah.
Let's get to meme of the week. And this is another AI meme, I think. David, we got some characters here that are AI generated. And I recognize a few. This is from Wrong Nebula. Be right back. Calling Amazon Studios. I don't know if they did some sort of Midjourney AI thing where they mm-hmm. combined like Lord of the Rings characters if they were well-known right. crypto villains, let's call
yeah.
them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But here's one. I think I recognize this individual.
Yeah, it's Gary Gensler as an orc. Yeah. Uh-huh. As like a knight. Yeah, oh, there's Sam Bankman-Fried as Gollum. That checks out. This one took me a second. Who is this in the Lord of the Rings?
This is the new Lord of the Rings, Rings of Power. It's kind of one of the elf kings, I think. Okay. But the face took me a second too. Who is this face? I think we determined this when we were trading this around.
This has got to be Alex Mashinsky, right?
Yeah, this is Alex Mashinsky as an elf. And then I guess Doug Kwan is the dwarf.
Yeah.
Is that what we're looking at here?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Well, the blessings of
AI. Oh, God, it keeps going.
Yeah, we've got Brian Armstrong here. Okay. Like, kind of the nice backlit uh-huh. heroes of crypto. Here's Vitalik.
Vitalik looks great as a hobbit.
He's a great hobbit. It looks like a great
hobbit. Or is he an elf? No, he's definitely a hobbit. He's definitely
who's this?
Who is that?
It goes on. And look, an AI generated all of this. Is this Jesse Powell from Kraken?
I want to think that's Ben from Optimism, but I don't think that's right.
Look, this is Charles.
That's clearly Charles. God, these are great. Yeah. I didn't realize how many of these there were. This is
amazing.
Fun. Yeah.
Anyway, guys, hope you enjoyed. This is, I guess, turned into AI week at Bankless, but got to end the show here. Risks and disclaimers. Of course, none of this has been financial advice. Crypto is risky. ETH is risky. So is Bitcoin. So is DeFi. You could definitely lose what you put in. But David went west, and we are headed west, and we're glad to have you on the Bankless journey. Thanks a lot.
Hey, we hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, head over to Bankless HQ right now to develop your crypto investing skills and learn how to free yourself from banks and gain your financial independence.
We recommend joining our daily newsletter, podcast, and community as a Bankless Premium subscriber to get the most out of your Bankless experience. You'll get access to our market analysis, our alpha leaks, and exclusive content, and even the Bankless token for airdrops, raffles, and unlocks. If you're interested in crypto, the Bankless community is where you want to be. Click the link in the description to become a Bankless Premium subscriber today. Also, don't forget to subscribe to the channel for in-depth interviews with industry leaders, Ask Me Anythings, and weekly roll-ups where we summarize the week in crypto and other fantastic content. Thanks everyone for watching and being on the journey as we build out the Bankless Nation.